everyone, and welcome back to Trading Secrets. Alexander of Macedonia, or as most of us know him, Alexander the Great, arrived in the Indian subcontinent in 326 BCE. His conquest in the Indus region in what is now Pakistan is widely accepted as a crucial part in studying Indian history and archaeology, and possibly the most important intercultural event that could have taken place in the Indian subcontinent. But why? Alexander, the son of Philip II, was the king of Macedon, a kingdom north of the Greek city-states. He revolutionized warfare and expanded his kingdom, covering large swaths of the known world. He conquered Egypt, named a big city after himself. Actually, he named lots of cities after himself as he grew his empire. A lot of what we know about him comes from the historians who traveled with him and documented what they witnessed. None of these works survive anymore, and we get historians a few centuries later referring to the earlier historians. After defeating his greatest enemy to the east, Darius III of the Persian Empire in 331 BCE, he continued his conquest eastwards to know the limits of the continent and to establish a frontier for his new kingdom. He got as far as the Indus floodplains, and no further than that. After his troop mutinied, he retreated to Persia and later died in Babylon. After he died heirless, his generals divided his massive empire among themselves. So for example, Ptolemy started the Ptolemaic dynasty in Egypt, and in the Gandhara region, the Seleucid Empire was formed by Seleucus Nicator. But what happened prior to Alexander's retreat to Babylon, while he was chilling at the northwest frontier, is the bit that different historians interpret differently. One narrative goes somewhat like this. A young Indian man by the name of Chandragupta Maurya met Alexander, possibly learned the new military style of Macedonia, and subsequently conquered the majority of northern India to create the enormous Maurya Empire that lasted from 322 BCE to roughly 185 BCE. It spanned from the Ganges all the way to parts of Afghanistan after he defeated Seleucus Nicator. This version's understanding is that Chandragupta Maurya was inspired by the greatness of Alexander and wanted to create an empire like that of Macedonia. And so early British historians place Alexander at the pivotal point in the shift of Indian politics. The pre-independence Indian nationalist narrative, on the other hand, goes a bit like this. Alexander came, and then he left, because he couldn't defeat the Indian kingdoms. All well and good, but Chandragupta Maurya realized that India must be protected from foreign invaders, and that a united empire was necessary to keep foreign invasions at bay. As India was never a united country, was what the British argued, the Maurya Empire came to represent the first of the united Indian identity that the pre-1947 freedom movement could use to their advantage to fight against the British and gain independence. These are two opinions of the same event interpreted in two almost entirely opposing manners. As archaeologists and historians, it is important to recognize when and how history is recorded, interpreted, and subsequently retold. We sit comfortably in the 21st century with the benefits of being able to look back at nearly two centuries worth of interpretations and recognize their individual biases. Both of them agree that Alexander's entry into Indian history was an event worth noting. The facts were these. From the late 1700s, early Indologists, or people studying Indian history, such as Sir William Jones, had learned Sanskrit and other Indian languages to start decoding ancient Indian texts. Some people will tell you they did so to rewrite Indian history and to manipulate it to rule over the Indian subcontinent. But I believe a large part of it is just honest human curiosity. Was it knee-deep in colonial bias? Yes, of course it was. But not all of them were out to actively destroy Indian history. Their thick colonial glasses did cloud their judgment. And just like today, each historian had a different approach from the one that came before them. Nevertheless, these were historians with knowledge of classical Greek and Roman histories and a growing fascination for Indian history. They knew that in Plutarch's history called Life of Alexander, Alexander met an Indian king called Sandrakotos or Andrakotos, whose capital was at Palibotra. As they became more acquainted with the Hindu Puranas and other literature, Sir William Jones, in a light bulb moment, was able to recognize that Chandragupta Maurya was the same person as Sandrakotos mentioned in these Greco-Roman texts, and that Palibotra was the city of Pataliputra. And suddenly, so much of Indian history fell into its chronological place, like scattered iron filings aligning themselves over a magnet. with 326 BCE as a fixed date and the help of numerous Hindu, Jain and Buddhist texts from India and Sri Lanka, historians trace the genealogies of the Indian kingdoms to calculate the dates of Chandragupta's grandson, King Ashoka's ascension to the throne and his eventual conversion to Buddhism. Because Ashoka is such a prominent Indian king, texts related to him help the historians to, for the first time ever, ascertain the dates of Gautam Buddha. We now know that Buddha supposedly achieved Nirvana in 483 BCE. How cool is that? As they unraveled Indian chronology, they also ended up giving Alexander the Foreigner a more active role in Indian history. Sir William Jones was relatively respectful of Indian history as he lived in India and became familiar with the culture. James Mill, on the other hand, was your typical colonial man who never even went to India and declared that the people lacked original thought and its progress was very much the result of European interventions. His book, The History of India, became popular in not just the UK, but also was taught in Indian schools. So the nationalists sought to remedy that. And they aren't wrong. Chandragupta Maurya should have more agency. But the political situation at the time meant that Chandragupta's actions weren't seen as being inspired by Alexander, but as a reaction to him, to protect the Indian subcontinent at all costs. But what they failed to acknowledge was that he was just another man trying to establish a big kingdom because he wanted to. In fact, before him, the Nanda dynasty already tried to create a large empire in India. So Chandu wasn't even the first one. So history can be told and retold depending on who wants to tell it and who's listening. But is there anything that is set in stone? Well, I am an archaeologist, aren't I? Alexander's arrival to the Indian subcontinent was accompanied by new cultures, art forms, and languages. Ashoka's Maurya Empire seems to have engaged most with them. The archaeological site of Takshashila is both a literal and metaphorical goldmine of intercultural art assimilation. There are pillars showcasing both Indian and Greek influences, also seen in Ashoka's pillars bearing his edicts. Ashoka made use of Greek and Aramaic to spread his message in the northwest of his kingdom, and he clearly wanted the Greeks to know them too. The kingdoms that followed Alexander's demise kept with the Indo-Greek traditions. The Scythians and the Kushana minted coins bearing not just Greek and Indian gods, but also used Greek and Indian scripts. Multilingual evidence such as these helped Lord Princip eventually decipher Brahmi, one of India's oldest scripts. The Gandhara region is most famous for its beautiful Buddha statues flaunting both Indian and Greek art styles carved in stone. But even stone cannot escape interpretation. Early colonial historians saw the Greek art as being an inspiration for Indian artists, as though they're trying to be more Greek. And currently, scholars are revisiting these interpretations to decolonize and denationalize them, trying to find a balance between the Indian and Greek artistic influences, to see them not as one having an upper hand over the other, but as a mutual exchange. So the way I see it, while foreign invasions are very not good, when you look at the ones that occurred nearly 2,000 years ago, instead of manipulating them to serve a political agenda, I only see the beauty that comes out of the amalgamation of arts and cultures. I see the objects and the scripts carved in stone and wonder how different they may have been if these important events never occurred. It's also important not to see Indian history just on its own, as though it happened independently from the rest of the world. If that were the case, we would have never been able to date Ashoka. Oh no, not that one. And not that kind of dating. Although, and lest we forget, we don't call a victorious person Chandragupta. We call him Sikandar. If you enjoyed this video, do let me know in the comments below. And as usual, don't forget to like, subscribe, and share it with your friends. I'll see you again soon. Bye-bye!